Hello there, everyone. It's nice to be able to talk to you all again. I hope you're all keeping well, healthy and happy. In this video, I'm going to be speaking about the concept of natural law. Now, you might wonder, why am I going to be speaking about natural law? And the answer is simple, because natural law is the foundation and the bedrock of all that we know as civilization. Okay? And isn't it interesting, ladies and gentlemen, isn't it interesting that none of the things that I'm going to be speaking about are actually taught in schools? Because these ideas, the ones that allow civilization to continue existing because they're so basic, because they're totally ignored, well, we've got a totally ignorant and ill-informed population right now in almost every Western country. What is that all about? And does that help, perhaps, the people that want to maintain their political strongholds and power strongholds that they've got, the power structures? There could be a reasonable argument to say yes. There really could. But anyway, let's get into this. And you'll find out why this is so important. The concept of natural law emerged from Greek philosophy. So you had philosophers like Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, who posited the existence of this thing called natural justice or natural right. And the latter, natural right, in this context, refers to two things. One is the sense of that you have, or that I may have, of right and wrong. Okay, what is right, what is wrong from a moral perspective? So it sets out an ethical framework, if you will. The other is the sense of the concept of rights as you know them, right? So if you have a right, you see? So this was all set out in ancient Greek philosophy. Aristotle himself later on was deemed to be the father of natural law. But this may be because St. Thomas Aquinas, who was another great thinker, in his book Summa Theologica, or his work, conflated natural law and natural right, the latter of which was proposed in Aristotle's Eudemian Ethics, Book 4. So if you want to look up the origin of the concept of natural justice or natural right, you can look back to that particular work. Aristotle noted that natural justice branched off from political justice, more specifically distributive and corrective justice. And natural justice, he believed, could probably only be established under the best political community. And when it came to the law, so in the form of law, this could constitute natural law, which is a really interesting idea. But he kind of almost argues against that in his work, The Politics, where he argues that the best regime may in fact not be ruled by law at all. And that's an interesting idea because it mirrors the very same concepts that we find in anarchism, right? So anarchists, the original anarchists, you might say, not the case any longer, because you see, anarchism got tied in with communism much later down the line. This is part of the problem. You get all variations of anarchists, by the way. You get anarcho-capitalists, you get anarcho-communists. You get people that are more inclined towards the free market and more libertarian in their ethos. Whichever realm you look at these days, it's all pretty subverted, unfortunately. But anarchy at its root, and I explained this in one of my videos, if you break down the word anarchist, right? The first part of that word in the original Greek, an, means without. The second part comes from the root Greek word archos, which means ruler, right, or rulers. And the last part, ist, comes from the Greek istes, which means one who does or one who lives. So if you were to truly interpret that entire word, it would tell you one who lives without rulers, right? It does not mean one who lives without rules. Because again, moral and ethical frameworks are necessary, right? But it's an interesting to me that just as an aside, that Aristotle even did contemplate that in his time. He also asserts in Eudemian Ethics that the virtue of mildness lies somewhere between temperance and liberality. So right in the middle. The synthesis, if you will, as put forward by Hegel, Hegelian's dialectic, if you will. But that has origins that are far older. And this goes back to the Kabbalistic concepts, which I've covered in one of my videos as well. It's the video on the occult, I believe it is, in the breakdown of the Economist cover for 2017. If you want to have a look at that, you can. But in Kabbalistic tradition, you're always aiming to travel the pillar of mildness, and the same thing you see carried through into Hermetic traditions. And of course, we see this in the Greek philosophic ideas as well, from Aristotle here, the virtue of mildness, right? You're always trying to travel the middle path between severity and mercy, or as Aristotle puts it, temperance and liberality. So it's just a very interesting mirror to me. In the Rhetoric, his work, The Rhetoric, which is a treatise on the art of persuasion, which was important back in those days as well, and this is part of the reason why they used to teach rhetoric as part of the trivium, grammar, logic, rhetoric, right? The rhetorical devices that were thought of at the time, the use of language, was known to be a persuasive tool. But that could only come about after you had gone through the process of thinking. So, to put it in the terms that we understand today, you have input, process, output, now from a technological perspective. But the same is true of the human being in many other respects. The rhetoric is what you process as your output. So, for example, me speaking to you right now, that is a form of rhetoric, right? And it's a pretty powerful tool. And we'll later get into why those tools exist, by the way, why rhetoric exists, why we're capable of these communications that we are, or these forms of communication. Now, the Rhetoric was written in the 4th century BC. And in that, Aristotle argues that there is a common law that is according to nature. So here he's actually putting forward the first ideas of natural law, really. Perhaps this is why he's seen as the father of natural law, because he's really putting these ideas together here. That there would be a universal, if you will, to use another word, law for humanity. A universal framework that may govern human behavior was a concept that was groundbreaking at the time, because very few people had thought of it. So that was very useful, of course, because we know that human beings, all in all, have fairly similar natures in terms of the basic aspects of humans as a species. And so we find similar behavioral aspects in any human society. That being said, of course, there are very strong differentiations due to not only socialization, as the postmodernists might claim, but also because of biology. Biology plays a key role in virtually everything that we do. So minor genetic changes affect how communities may or may not manifest different aspects of the human being, right? So, for example, if there's a prevalence of intelligence that may have genetic origins or roots among people, then those societies that have the most intelligent people will thrive in a particular direction. The ones that don't may rely more on perhaps other things, right? There are different gifts, if you will, right? So, anyway, getting back on point. Aristotle quotes Sophocles and Empedocles in the following. He says, "Universal law is the law of nature." So here he's talking about universal law or natural law. "For there is a natural justice and injustice that is binding on all men, even on those who have no association or covenant with each other." And so Empedocles, when he bids us kill no living creature, he is saying that to do this is not just for some people, well, unjust for others. So it's not just for some, but it's also unjust for others. That's a pretty interesting idea. Because that final statement there can be interpreted as a bid not to visit violence on others who have not initiated violence against us. It could be the origins and the beginnings of the non-aggression principle, put simply, or the golden rule, right? So that's really, really revealing in and of itself, that many of the ideas that people talk about in political circles today, or philosophical structures today, they have their origins in Aristotelian thought, which is really cool. So, these ideas were further developed much, much later down the line by the Stoics. And the Stoics looked at the idea of natural justice and natural law that was put forth by Aristotle, and they asserted the existence of a rational and purposeful order to the universe. Because at that time, we'd come full circle with starting to understand the sciences, and the philosophical realm was opening up to all kinds of different types of thinking. So they realized that the universe had a certain order to it, right? Now, whether you look at it from a deistic perspective and say, well, it was a top-down engineered system or a bottom-up engineered system, as the atheists claim, it's irrelevant. The point is that there is a system in place and there is an order to it. And the Stoics saw that and they said, well, this order seems to have a purpose behind it. And it does. It actually does. The whole universe, you see, the whole universe exists to process, for processes to happen. And this is an interesting thing because it means that there is a purpose to it all, right? Not in any sense that we might fully grasp or comprehend, because that's an objective reality perhaps we may never fully get to understand just because of our limitations. However, it is there. And the fact that the Stoics saw this, and again, it's irrelevant whether one is a theist or a deist or an atheist in terms of this particular perspective, because nobody can argue with the fact that there is meaning and purpose to it all, right? It's just not, it doesn't, but that doesn't mean that that translates to a microscopic level as such, unless we make it. And I would argue this is the point of the Stoics. So this universal order, the purpose behind it, the rationality to it all, and we know, by the way, that the universe conforms to all these laws, because, well, we know, for example, in physics, that we can describe the universe almost perfectly in mathematical terms. So there's something to that. I mean, the idea itself is far more complex. But anyway, they were just starting out at this point, so we'll have to cut them some slack. So they dubbed this universal order eternal law. And They said that the means by which a rational being lived in accordance with this eternal law was the natural law. And this amounts to action in accordance with virtue. And this is incredibly important because this is the point at which, and I think again it has its beginnings in Aristotle's work, actions have consequences. A lot of people won't tell you this. This is part of the reason why natural law fundamentally boils down to this axiom. All actions have consequences because there is universal order. Okay? And if you're not perceiving that, if you're not at least even contemplating the consequences that your actions will have, and you're not guided by a moral or ethical framework, then you will never ever truly understand or see the importance of right action. Okay? And what do we define as right action? Well, we'll come to that a little bit later on, but to put it simply, because these are enormously complex ideas that we're dealing with here, but to put it simply, anything that would benefit you or others around you, preferably simultaneously, is right or good, right? So, anything that disadvantages yourself or other people is a wrong. We could put it in those simple terms. That needs to be fleshed out much, much more, but I don't want to take up too much time with this argument. But basically, the less damage we do to others, the better it is. In fact, if we can do no damage, which was what Empedocles put forward, then absolutely, yes, that would be the best way to move forward in life, right? To minimize your footprint, if you like. Not the carbon footprint, right? But the other kinds of footprints we leave. If we do things that are harmful out of malice or, you know, things like this, they have consequences. Violence absolutely and certainly does. But we'll get into that a little bit later on, as I say. So, right action in accordance with virtue, okay? Action, consequence. These are very important concepts. This philosophical view was championed and represented by two primary Stoic philosophers, those being Cicero and Seneca. And you must look into the works of Cicero and Seneca if you want to grasp or grapple with or understand what any of their thoughts really were on these matters, because they are very deep. Probably two of the most brilliant thinkers around. Of course, prior to them, we could say the same thing of Socrates and Aristotle. So, the Stoics held the view that within humans is a divine spark, right? So this kind of, see, again, what's interesting to me isn't the question of deism versus atheism, right? And I'll tell you, I'm just mentioning that because a lot of people might take umbrage to the concept of divinity, right? But what is the difference between that, if it's understood in this Aristotelian fashion, what is the difference between saying that there is a divine spark in someone and saying that they are made of the same matter as was there in the beginning of the universe? Okay, so I don't think there is any distance between those two arguments at all, right? In my mind. So if the phrase divine spark bothers you, you really need to get out of your shell and try and understand that when they were talking about divinity, they weren't necessarily talking about divinity in the same sense that superstitious people might be. What they were talking about is to view the universe with awe and to see divinity in it, to see the natural order in it, the purposeful order, the eternal law, as they called it, you see? So, anyway, sorry, that's just an aside. I hope I'm not boring you too much with that. So this divine spark allows humans to live in accordance with nature. And by the word nature, they weren't referring to it the way we understand nature as some sort of ambiguous, amalgamous, throwaway word. They were talking about, again, the purposeful order, the eternal law. And this idea later gave way to the idea of the equality of mankind. Right? Now, this is pretty interesting. So, all of these ideas, as they've developed through the ages, led to the conclusions by the Stoics that the value of human beings was equal. Okay, this is where people go wrong in their thinking and their understanding of what these concepts meant. Because, you see, again, our intelligence has been taken away from us in a great many ways by the power structures which exist. So, what has ended up happening is that when people hear the phrase, and you'll see why this is important later on, that all men are created equal, well, they start thinking, well, that must mean that all people are the same. No. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Now, when we talk about equality, if you talk about that as a mathematical principle, what are you talking about? You're talking about value. If you talk about it from a philosophical standpoint, you're still talking about value. How we judge the value of human beings is a whole different idea to whether or not human beings are the same. Right across the board, and they're not. And that was certainly not what the Stoics were saying. It's certainly not what the founding fathers were saying, and you'll see the role they play later on in all of this. But the most important thing is that equality refers to the value of human beings, not to their abilities, not to their genetic traits, not to anything else. Right? If we were to say black people and white people have equal value, or in the very best of situations can provide equal value. Do we see that as a true fact? Yes. Yes, we do. Not in all cases. Sometimes you find that certain types of communities do dreadfully in certain situations, right? And can't provide that same value as other communities. But that may be down to a myriad of many factors, right? So, and a lot of these things are complex and nuanced, right? But nonetheless, if you take two people from two different communities, if you like, or two different places, or of different races, or it doesn't, or genders, it doesn't really matter, right? The value they have, or the value they can provide in the best of situations, is still the same. If they're equally capable, then they are equally able. That's the point, you see? So that's what we're really talking about. I mean, again, I'm sorry for kind of going off on a tangent there, but this is so important for people to understand that. You know, the social justice warriors, these regressive leftists, what they've done, the radical leftists, what they've done is they've taken this pure and noble idea, which is grounded and based in true empirical philosophical understanding, and they've perverted it. And it's disgusting what they've done with it. Because different people have different needs, different abilities, different lives. Different, yeah, I mean, everything's different for every human being because we're individuals. The whole point is that we are individuals. So anyway, I'll try and calm down. So anyway, Cicero in his work, De Legibus, states that justice and law originate from what nature has given to man. From what the human mind embraces, from the function of man, from what serves to unite humanity. So he's looking at all the, Cicero was looking at the faculties of man, some of which we'll talk about later on as well, and we'll build on that. But the faculties of man oblige him, he says, to contribute to the general good of society. Now, the next part is very interesting. Laws should exist to provide tranquility and happiness for human life, he says, and the safety of citizens. Thus, wicked and unjust laws are anything but laws, which should have the inherent principle of choosing what is just and true. He's talking about justice and truth. Do you know who else talks about justice and truth? Just as an interesting humorous aside. Superman. You know the comic book character Superman? He talks about truth, justice, and the American way. Do you know why he does? And I'm not even kidding about this, by the way. I'm deadly serious. Okay? Superman champions truth, justice, and the American way. What is the American way? Well, early on in the 18th century, when America was in its infancy, during its time as a British colony, the British polemicist Thomas Gordon incorporated Cicero into his work throughout the colonies, and he decisively, as all historians virtually agree, he decisively shaped early American political culture. Let's go deeper into that rabbit hole, because this is the American way that we're now talking about here. American revolutionaries such as James Wilson, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, and many, many, many others valued his work and were influenced greatly by it, calling him a foremost model of virtue and forensic eloquence, a moral philosopher, the father of eloquence and philosophy. I'd like to read you something. This is the introduction to the Declaration of Independence for the United States of America. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitled them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to separation. Within that, they're talking about the laws of nature, natural law. The United States of America was founded on the principle of natural law. It was founded on the principle of natural law. Now that's a heck of a thing. That's the American way. The American way, that tradition, harkens back to Cicero. And before Cicero to Aristotle. But you see, somewhere along the line, America lost its way. The ideals of the founding fathers, based on natural law, the existence of small government for the people and by the people, the importance of individual freedoms and liberties. The individual contributing voluntarily to greater society without the use of violence or coercive force. That is the land of the free and the home of the brave. You see? And as I say, America lost its way. It shouldn't have done. It shouldn't have done. But the reason it did is because all of these things were not taught to the young. They were not taught to young people. When kids are in school today in the States, they don't get to learn any of this. They don't get to learn about the beautiful, rich history of American philosophy. And you think, you really do, it makes you think, how can we create civilization or maintain civilization if we don't understand the underpinning principles of it? And you know, we see the echoes of the thoughts of the founding fathers in the work of Cicero. We really do. Where he was talking about laws providing tranquility and happiness, the pursuit of happiness, basically, which is where that idea comes from, for human life, the safety of its citizens, the importance of individuality, the importance of justice even, you know. You could even look at Seneca's work and see similar or greater ideas. You know, the Stoics, remarkable, remarkable philosophers, as were the Greeks. And that's what it all actually goes back to. It is the Greek tradition of philosophy, you see? And look at the depth of it all. I mean, 30 minutes, you and I have been talking about this, and look at the depth of it all. Yeah? What we started off just using the phrase natural law, right? But look at what it all entails. It's a plethora of information. It's a plethora of thought, of inquiry, of process. And it's all been robbed from us. It's been taken away because people don't want us to know these things. The moral frameworks that must govern us, the ethical frameworks that must govern us, our actions being as much in accordance with the laws of nature, as they put it, a natural law, as is possible. And natural law, to the Stoics, equated to, of course, to the concept of justice. And what is justice but the concept of equality? And what is equality but a concept of value? You see, so there's different categories within categories that were explored. And what's happened is, over the years, there has been a powerful force of anti-intellectualism that is exploding these categories and destroying them so that we can't move forward in our thinking, in our thoughts. I mean, these are basic building blocks. We should all know these things. These are the basics. What we really should be trying to do is to build beyond that, to build on that, to see further, because we can stand on the shoulders of these amazing giants, these amazing men, these amazing philosophers. You see, go further than that. But we're not doing that. Instead, people have been so busy trying to dismantle all the things that make society work. But anyway, I hope that's been informative. I hope that's not too depressing a note to end on. It's just, you know, you look at these things and sometimes you get disheartened. But I'll tell you where the hope lies, actually. The hope lies in the fact that if we can understand these basic ideas, right? Natural law, universal law, moral laws, the eternal laws. If we can understand these, if we can grasp them, the idea of actions and consequences, Newtonian laws, in a sense, really, right? The laws of physics, the laws of mathematics, these are all extensions of these laws, really, in true terms. So, if we can do that, if we can learn to be conscious of our actions or thoughts, then we can break free of these ignorant actions and the terrible things that we do as a species to other people. Whether it's because we've gone too far in one direction of compassion and mercy, which happens sometimes, and people start destroying one individual to save another, and then develop genocidal tendencies as a result, or whether we're adhering too strongly with the principle of severity, where we become too harsh and end up, again, becoming genocidal. That's why the real path, the true path, as Aristotle pointed out, as the Kabbalistic philosophers pointed out, as pretty much anyone who has really looked at it has pointed out, even in politics, you're always aiming for the center ground. You've always, even in from a microscopic perspective, never mind the macroscopic, you're aiming for that middle path. You're always aiming for that middle path. You know? And I just wish we taught more people that, I guess. That's my point. You know? And I think we will. I think we will. I think we'll get beyond this point where everything's about nihilism and destruction and, you know, all these preoccupations that we've got as a civilization right now. I think they will pass. But the destruction that they're going to wrought on humanity until they do, that's the concern we have, really, you know. But I'll leave you with that, and I'll tell you something else before I go. Final thought, if you will. Freedom. Freedom's an interesting idea, isn't it? We talked about freedoms and rights. Why is free speech so important? Why is truth so important? Why is justice so important? Because if we were talking about natural law, well, by nature, through evolution, we developed speech so that we could communicate ideas, so that we could determine objective truth from unreality. Because this helped us to hunt animals. If we could coordinate and agree with our fellow tribesmen, then we could go out there and hunt the animal in close coordination, right? If we agreed on the objective reality that, look, there's an animal, we need to kill it so that we can eat it, right? Similarly, in gathering societies where perhaps, you know, there wasn't such an abundance of animals to hunt, well, there again, there's still coordination necessary. And so, in order to simply survive and to thrive as a species, we had to understand objective truth. I would argue a lot of animals actually have to do that, but we developed that into the ability to communicate ideas through speech, which is why we have vocal cords, right? And then, of course, we evolved reasoning skills. Because if we could reason, then we could problem solve. So if there's a shortage of food, and based upon the available information, we could migrate to a place which had more food or whatever else, you know? But it's these faculties that we developed that allowed early human civilizations to exist. And that is nature at work. So if we're talking about natural law, well, this is why free speech matters so much. Free speech matters, truth matters, because objective truth and free speech are incorporated into our evolution. They actually are an evolutionary product. Right? And we could argue so is justice, by the way. The concept of equality, the concept of value. All living creatures living according to his or her gifts. So, when you see people trying to curb free speech, to silence people or to visit violence upon them, the initiators of violence, or trying to ensure that the state visits violence upon them, we're destroying civilization. This is why it ends up being a destructive act. It's why it's nihilistic. Right? Get rid of free speech, get rid of truth, get rid of justice, and you've destroyed everything that allowed human beings to survive, to exist. So, as an argument from conclusions, we might even say, we can say that this is moral to have free speech, to have free speech, to have ideas exploring truth, objective truth, is moral. Moral, correct, and just. And what is immoral is the prevention of free speech, truth, and justice. See? So, this is what we need to understand. And by we, I'm not talking about you guys. Because believe it or not, chances are if you're watching this, if you're sitting through this, okay, you're probably already really familiar with some of these ideas. Okay, you're probably on board with all of this. The importance of freedom, truth, right action, right? But this needs to get out there more. More people need to be talking about it. More people need to be teaching people about these things because too few are. And that's why we're seeing the collapse of civilization. It's why we're seeing all the nihilism, is because, people don't understand. People don't understand this. Anyway, I'll leave it there for this video because I think I've gone on a little bit too long here on these matters. But I hope that has been informative, that it has helped you to grasp these ideas if you didn't already. I'm sure you did to some extent. And I hope to talk to you again soon when there's something else to talk about, I want you to take it easy for just now. Take good care of yourselves and make sure that you continue to do all the great work in your own life that you can, because you can't neglect yourself. Okay? So take good care. God bless you. Speak again soon.